I'm John Enright. I'm the Vice Director here at SCI-Arc. What a great evening we're going to have tonight. We're really honored to have Ray Kappe in discussion with Hernan Diaz Alonso today. And of course, both of them really don't need extensive introductions to this audience. As we know, Ray is the founding director of SCI-Arc and Hernan the newly appointed director. And I suspect we're in for a wonderful discussion about the state of architecture, perhaps, and education. I'm really glad to see all the alumni in the audience tonight. And I hope to see you, here's a plug, our main event, March 12th, at the Sound in Hollywood. Somebody lost a wallet, I think. Of course, that is for student scholarships of at the school. One thing I wanted to mention, and it's always a pleasure to have Ray and Shelley Kappe here at SCI-Arc. I remember almost 30 years ago when I first came to Los Angeles, and Tom Main said to me, "You got to go visit Kappe and see his house." I was about 24. And I remember going there and how Ray and Shelley were so generous with who they didn't know me from anyone, with their time and really, I think, countless young architects have been the beneficiary of their warmth and graciousness, and we're also grateful to them both, so I wanted to mention that. Okay, this is just about a 5-minute setup. I wanted to point some things out for this discussion. For those of you who don't know, we've started a new program that Hernan started, Duels and Duets, and this is our third one. Ray mentioned to me that he forgot his sword, but I think he's packing anyway. I thought I would show a few slides, maybe of some similarities between these two people who I know pretty well, that maybe serves them as points of discussion that they'll go forward with. Maybe they'll speak about the differences in the school's evolution. We might note that both of them started their directorships at the age of 45, which I thought was interesting. Maybe they'll talk about technology. On the left is the first computer at SCI-Arc, 1978, Commodore PET. At the right, some more recent machines. They're both interested in technology, and they both are part of that history at SCI-Arc. Media, again, around the same time, advent of video. And at the right, the new program that SCI-Arc has launched, that Hernan has come up with, SCI-Arc Channel, taking it to maybe a whole other level. And of course, we should note that SCI-Arc, and Shelley and Ray and the faculty were ahead of their time in documenting all of the lectures at SCI-Arc, which all of you know now are on the SCI-Arc archive, which is visited by scholars worldwide of literally 43 years of events at SCI-Arc, as is this one tonight being taped. Maybe they'll talk about cars. I have a similar interest in cars of the German variety. But maybe they'll debate whether black or silver is the proper car color for a Porsche. I'd like to hear that one. Or maybe they'll talk about their work. Of course, on the left is the famous Kappe House of 1967. On the right is I forget the name of it, a house that Hernan did in Argentina. And I don't know about you, but I see a lot of similarities here. External and internal nature are both incorporated in both these projects. An interest in reflection and transparency clearly is evident. Structural articulation, both of them are interested. And probably my favorite, butterfly chairs, butterfly meat. So, finally, and more seriously, Ray and Hernan are both leaders in education. Ray having won the ACSA's highest honor, the Topaz Medallion, in 1990. Hernan also receiving the LAAIA's Educator of the Year 2 years ago. But most importantly, they share a passion, a commitment, and a love of SCI-Arc that is their greatest similarity. which is evident in their continued ability to inspire generations of aspiring young architects and students, which is why we're all here. So please join me in a warm welcome for Ray Kappe and Hernan Diaz Alonso.
Thank you, John, for that introduction. First, a couple of housekeeping before we get into the conversation. The first thing is, it goes without saying, as John was mentioning, it's a pleasure and honor to have Ray here and always Shelley. I like to think that they are my friends. And of course, the whole history of the school, but I want to point out that the genesis of this conversation was during the last summer series of talks and meetings with the alumni council, Beth and Dan particularly, in which we thought, and I suggest it was a good idea that alumni associations start to have at least one event a year that they will be interested in talk. And in talking with them, we came to the conclusion that Ray was the most obvious choice for the first one. So hopefully this is the first one of many to come in which the alumni takes the leadership in being part of this conversation. So I want to point that out because I think it's an important step and it's a different change of direction. Now, specifically to try to have a conversation with Ray, I know it's not gonna be easy because Ray is a man of very precise but short sentences in his affirmations. So I'm gonna try to do my best to see how much information we can get out of him. Which is, he's a mystery man, which is one of the many qualities I love about Ray. So I want to start with something very basic that for some of you is probably old news, but for some of us is not so evident. Of course, SCI-Arc, as we know, is Southern California Institute of Architecture. And in a conversation I had years ago with Ray and his house, he told me that actually the origin of it is this one, science architecture. That's what his heart was when him and a bunch of mavericks and rebels decide to go in a different direction about what architecture education should be and how we would thought. And now looking back, it's very strange because it's not always the way that I would argue that SCI-Arc has been perceived by the people. I mean, they tend to associate ours with a much more artistic or free, or you will see later on in some of the pictures based on their hair, almost quasi hippie attitude too. But really the true origin of SCI-Arc and the word SCI-Arc, according to Ray, and I have to take his word that this is true, and we'll find out soon enough. And I think it has to do with his origin in the interest on that, and clearly in 72, the whole notion of technology and space, there was many other aspects that one may not think at first glance that was the origin of SCI-Arc. So maybe it's not really maybe a question, but as a way to start the conversation, if you can say to all these people what you told me that night about why that was something that you thought that was the right way to start the foundation of a different way to understand architecture education?
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, that period, late 60s and sort of mid 60s to the time we started here, was a period when people were looking at trying to see architecture rather than what it had been, which some tended to be a little more intuitive, and the language wasn't there. I mean, nobody was really talking architectese. And USC was attempting to do, when Sam Hurst came, to really put together a program that had a more rational base to it. And they had various professors there, Ralph Knowles, for one, who Tom studied with and Jim Stafford studied with, and maybe some of you others have, but and then also Robert Anderson. And and several others. And in that process, I started hearing, since I taught there a couple of times, I really just substituted a couple of times for other architects. One was my mentor, Carl Maston, and later on, Paul Bailey, who was leaving town or something. But it was really interesting to me because I started to think differently than I had before. And I had never really thought of myself becoming an educator, but I was always interested in education as an intro. Okay, so then what happened, it always seemed to me that that program was a little out of whack in terms of the way it was structured, even though the discussions were quite good. And the idea of the science part of it was the fact that architecture, to me, seemed like it should be going in a more lineal fashion, and it tended to be really going cyclical. In other words, you'd come back on itself, and then it would cycle up a little bit. But it always seemed like we were starting all over again. Things would happen every so often that would change that. So, you know, after I had an opportunity because of a friend at Cal Poly who had just come on their landscape program, Bernard Zimmerman, had put my name into the discussion of who would be the chairman of architecture at a school that was going to become a school of environmental design. Landscape and planning were already there. And it gave me a special opportunity, I thought, to really make what I would hope would be, in that case, a very good school of environmental design. Okay, that hasn't anything to do with this science stuff to any great degree, except that the rational aspect really appealed to me. I had always, you know, designed post and beam, and my structures were fairly clear. I think my language was reasonably clear. But I had never really thought of it as a technology thing as much as I started to think later, and also how you would make decisions that seemed to be a little more intelligent. Anyway, I was selected to start that program. I was very fortunate that I could write my own program, hire my own people. Not very many heads of a program get to have that opportunity. And we had an interesting program then because Archigram was starting to come on strong in the mid-60s. And they were in town, and I would invite them to come out to Cal Poly as well. And there were students who also would come out. And so we did a lot of experimental stuff there with inflatables and various kinds of structures. And it was going very well, I thought. we did this project at near the end of my time. There was the rhombic dodecahedron. So look at close stacking behavior. That if you put people that tight together, what would it be like? Because those were the megastructural years and so forth. Anyway, they kept using architecture to feed in more students. I asked them to stop at 200 because that's the size of the other two programs, and they weren't growing. I mean, they were sort of static at about 200. And I thought if we were bigger, we would have problems in terms of getting power, you know, be more powerful and so forth. So, and that was going very well until one summer in 71, I come back and all of a sudden we're at 350. We started with 25 students. In 3.5 years, we grew to 350. Well, that creates a problem among the three disciplines. And so and the dean at that time, he was creating problems. And so I, at that point in time, asked him to come into my office because I wanted to talk to him because I felt he was being very divisive. And so that's what eventually broke it down. He asked me to retire. I mean, not retire, but leave my post a week later, and I said, what? That's pretty strange. And then it became a big cause celeb out there, and then people, some of the people here, I don't know, I can't even see where I am here, but the faculty started sort of an uprising with the students, and there was a big to-do and a big cause celeb. And then one day we said, why don't we start our own program? I was pretty much running the show anyway, other than the financial part. And so that became what we would become as SCI-Arc. So in thinking about it, I like the acronym. This is finally getting, I'm a man of few words.
No, but I'm already very excited we are to a good start because, I mean,
So anyway.
I knew that science would get you going.
Right. So anyway, you know, I was thinking about it, and I thought, well, you know, Southern California Institute of Architecture seemed like a nice thing to call ourselves. We weren't a university, we were an institute. And Southern California as a whole, rather than Los Angeles. And so that went through my head. And then I thought, well, that would make a great acronym, because that's what I believe in anyway. And that made the SCI-Arc. And in a sense, I was thinking the science of architecture, also dealing with technology, looking ahead, experimenting, creating a school that would be completely different. So that's where the name came from, and then from that grew our program in SCI-Arc, which I could keep on talking all night probably. And I'll go back to Hernan. We can probably pick up at another point.
The reason why for me that was a very interesting discovery, let's say, it was because in a way, to me, if you ask me where the school is right now, I think it's in a way it's kind of like full circle in terms of, and I'm not so sure it was a super conscious decision or just the forces that been in terms of the eruption of technology in relation to our discipline.
Yes.
So in a way, to me, it's an interesting thing because at the end of the day, in one way or another, the school always has been an intersection of that. The other thing which was interesting, but again, because when we think in 1970, 71, 72, the time that you guys were thinking, which today, frankly, I think it would be impossible, this idea that you will a group of people will walk away from an institution and go and start some other one. But there was this other aspect which I was pointed to with some of the images about NASA and so on, and this is what you guys still were at Cal Poly, but yeah. There is a clear relation with also what Japanese were doing to metabolism. There was a kind of a whole thing brewing in relation to it, which I think is an interesting notion. And I wonder how much the kind of a LA culture of the industrial building and so on, and the space, it was by the couldn't be Ray, right? I mean, Ray was close enough. So I don't know if that was the main reason why you guys choose that building, but this idea that also, again, I assume that there were certain things that were out of necessity, but like architects, we always make opportunity out of necessity. So I'm also intrigued by the idea of this notion of industrial building becoming an academic institution, an idea that by default, that will change a completely different dynamic about how people teach and learn, and a much more symbiotic. So out of basic principles, it was something that there was a clear blueprint, and it was something much more organic, like not to say you make it up as you go by, but there was a kind of, an ethical mission, and the infrastructure was, we make it work as the thing grows or change and so on, or how much it came by the visceral reaction to the status quo of the order of the university.
Well, you know, my feeling was once we left the university, was now everything was wide open by comparison. And when you're developing a curriculum at the university, there are certain requirements and there's certain ways to move around it to get where you want to go. And we did that at Cal Poly. But I thought, okay, so we have a program, fine, but let's toss it out. we'll get together with all the students who came, 50 came, plus 25, from April to October, 25 across the country, and came to join us. So we had 75 students starting out. We had the original faculty members, some of whom are here, that were there with me, which is very important because they had an energy that was special. You know, we had Tom Main, Bill Simone, and Glenn Small, Jim Stafford, if he's here, Adi Lati, who isn't here, and Shelley joined too because she was doing work out of Cal Poly with me just pro bono. She would come out and work on programs and other things that we would do there because the university was not so supportive of that. So anyway, what we decided to do, we walked into an empty building, 1972, the fall, October. Everybody sat down on the floor. It was completely empty. The students over the summer had gotten the building into shape. People had gone out and collected things that we could use. Students went up and down the state letting everybody know about the school. So a lot of this was happening, but you have to also realize the 1960s in the United States were rather special. They were tough years in many ways politically. You know, Jack Kennedy elected, started in office 61, assassinated 64. Johnson came in and started his Great Society. That's when we started Medicare and Medicaid. There were a lot of social programs that got through Congress, which you could play hell to get today. And Head Start was started then. I think there was a Peace Corps type of thing that had started in those years. And then you had Martin Luther King got assassinated, followed shortly by Robert Kennedy getting assassinated. And the Vietnam War was going on, and students at that time, you know, were being drafted, and a lot of them were objected to that war, and there was uprisings and so forth. So there was sort of this mentality, and then, you know, your flower children had the advent of the Beatles. I mean, it was kind of a, 60s were rather, you know, special years. And by 72, finally, we were pretty getting close to being out of the Vietnam War. Students were still, I think, you know, part of that whole revolution. And so the idea of starting a new school, I think, was revolutionary in a sense.
A footnote, you guys started the school with Nixon as the president.
Yes, I know.
And it made me think about Trump and what it would mean. Just saying, it's a footnote. Carry on.
Yeah,
just to add a scary moment in parallel, so okay, yeah, there is some hope.
Yeah, no, well, at that time, anyway. So we you know, students were so important in the whole process. We spent time together developing the program that we thought they might like, what could be. I thought maybe we'd find a new way of doing architectural education. It was all that kind of a thing that was going on. And I wanted them to really have a learning process, not necessarily one in which they were always given lectures and taught that way. So anyway, our first project was make your own place, you know? And how are you going to use the building? How are you going to do that? That was the first project in the school. And there were teams that were put together. It was a little difficult for students at that point. And gradually, though, two of our students here, who are here tonight too, John Sousa and Dean Noda, kind of took the lead in terms of developing the space itself. And I came up with the idea, let's do a scaffold system. They put it together, they made their floor panels. There's a picture that sometimes is shown where the dean drove his VW up on the panels in order to press them. And it was interesting. That's what made the school spaced over a period of time. And so, but it was also interesting to watch the way the students operated, because in the first weeks, we also had just a series of people wanting to come in and talk, seminars. So we'd have a stop and they'd have a seminar and we'd do this. And I thought it was fantastic myself, but then the students started to, please, can we be a little more, orderly here, so when are we going to start the real curriculum? And I thought, gosh, why? This is great so far. Why don't we just sort of keep this happening? But anyway, it gradually, because I think of their previous education and also the people teaching, their way of teaching before, didn't quite fit my kind of notion of what the whole thing, should be. But I always believed in freedom and change and so forth. So as time went on, there was a lot of energy, but gradually there was a change. Initially, Tom Main did a terrific little diagram. It looked more like a motor in a car, and how they could tie into whatever they wanted to do. And there was really nothing that said you have to take this semester, this year, this that year, but you could jump around in this diagram.
And it hasn't changed that much.
What? Okay.
For those who are the Tommy students, they know that still that way to go.
Okay. So anyway, that's the way this whole thing was happening. How we ended up with this building, which tended to be a good one to use, was that I wanted to move it into the west side because I had been driving, an hour out to Pomona three times a week, and I thought, and most of the people who came out, most of them were from the west side more than the east side. So I remembered a building that Van Keppel Green, who made modern outdoor furniture, and that was the main modern furniture at that time for exterior use. And there was this nice wooden building that was where they were. And by the time we went to look, Bill Simone and I were the ones sort of looking for what space we could maybe make work. And that building was already occupied by an elementary school, private one. But then there was this other building, just a few doors down, that was the one that we finally chose. And we looked at that, there was an automobile showroom that also was possible. But this building seemed really could be, first of all, there was code separations that were already in place, and we didn't have to do so much with that building as we would have had to do with the auto showroom, which was down in Santa Monica. And I also liked the idea that we were sort of in Santa Monica, those were the streets that were university streets. We were on Berkeley Street. There was Stanford next door, Harvard, Yale, So it seemed like, wow, this is good. Good company. And then there were many think tanks around. So it just seemed like there was lots of nice things, potential there. And so gradually that's the way it evolved slowly. I remember Bucky Fuller coming there and saying, one night we invited him and he said, this is the best learning environment I've ever seen. That was a nice compliment. And because he was one who was always you know, talking about how you really educate in a way that's more alternative. And there was a lot of discussions of alternative education too at that time. So all of that kind of went together. And you know, little by little it evolved and it changed. And eventually it became a little more normal in its curriculum base. But there was a process, in which it happened, not by, you know, talking about Trump, that kind of a method where this is my way or no way, but the idea that the whole community created this place. We had it where we didn't even have students in their own studios. I mean, everybody was in this one main space primarily, and they could be sitting next to a grad student, or they could be sitting next to a beginning student. And I had said to the faculty, it's our job to move around to these students and do our table crits. And at the same time as we're doing that, just let the other students hear what we're saying. And it seemed like a better growth process to me. So that was sort of the evolution that was taking place. And it was rather exciting. And the science of architecture at that time, of course, isn't like what I'd call the science today, really. The science today is really more computer-oriented and that way. And those days, the technology and science of it were about other factors that were different from that. They were, you know, those were the days of when Jim Stirling was doing his work in England. That work was more tech-oriented. Foster was doing his work, and Richard Rogers was doing their work. And again, I said the Archigram group, and there were others. So it was a whole, it was a different, you know, a different time that way. Computers were still punch cards. So that was a really slow process. I was trying to do a class just not in science or tech, but more in behavior. And it was so hard to really do it. UCLA was trying to bring in the computer more. And I would periodically go over there and say, well, how are you doing? And usually the program wouldn't work. And, you know, you had these big computers then and God knows what. And it just never seemed to get in place. And I thought to myself, well, we'll wait till the day when we can have desktop computers and people can have their own computer. And maybe by that time it makes sense.
First computer lab in the school.
Right.
1983.
So it was slow, but I thought it was about right. You know, it really is. As it evolved correctly. And also in the video, I sublet the space to a video group so that we would have the use of their video equipment. And we didn't charge them anything, but we did have that equipment. And I didn't believe in libraries, so it's strange that ours was for us, because there was a Santa Monica library, UCLA, USC. I thought, well, if students really want to go to the library, let them go do their research in those places. But eventually that was another one that prevailed. The students said, we want books. Okay, fine. But I thought we would work more on, you know, periodicals, which I think probably people look at more than they do it, a lot of books. And it was that kind of a process. It was easy to get, I mean, where I at Cal Poly, I couldn't get the other departments to collaborate with us on anything, because the faculty kept worrying they were gonna, you know, do something that they were gonna have they were putting in more time than they wanted to put in to be involved with this kind of a collaborative process, where I think the architects, landscape architects and planners were happy to, you know, interchange with others, but it wasn't really working. But when we started SCI-Arc, we could hire anybody in the city, and everybody wants to teach. It's very nice. So we were able to get all kinds of people, from people in the mayor's office to talk about political stuff that was going on in the city. We got all of that happening. And I remember one of the earliest seminars was from Sirodi, who was an assemblyman, I think, at the state level. He came down and talked. We had others who were talking about economics of the city and the political system. And so it was sort of oriented that way, and it was easy to do.
I want to go back in a bit to the profession discipline part, but we'll get back. But before we move into that, which is a sad way into your own practice and vision of architecture, I want to hear your insight about how important is the individual friction, individual ambitions, and how you build the faculty and the people. And you just said, well, we can hire anybody, which maybe there were these two guys, so there were just anybody that could be hired. But ultimately, I'm intrigued by that, because part of, let's say, in institution, but particular SCI-Arc, there is the reality what the school was or is, and there is the whole parallel reality of the myth of the construction. And in many ways, it seems like those years, there was a high level of intellectual friction, which sometimes bleach into personal friction. And how important was to create the right balance of collaboration and friction? Well, to spark the debate. And again, and I just find that picture of Michael and Tom, where I find it really funny. But also this would apply to Coy and Robert and many other people.
But that was
and in many ways, at this point, we don't even know if those stories are true or not.
No,
we hope they're all truth. Flying chairs and flare guns and all the stuff that it was make this such an extraordinary academic institution.
It wasn't quite that.
I know.
I mean, there was...
No, but I'm interested in the relation between friction and collaboration and individual ambitions and the collective, and how architecture in many ways as a cultural entity is a collective contraction, but it's fueled by the individual ambitions.
Yes, well... Well, I had, you know, as a director, you always have to have a vision, as you do now as each director.
Now you tell me.
Director. No, well, you know, because it's a little harder when you come into a fixed situation, although you've been around here for over a dozen years. But when you come into that, you don't have quite the latitude that I had. I mean, we had the founding faculty, but then it was a question of who would come next. And of course, being in California, if you're on the two coasts, it's pretty easy to get faculty members. You know, they all want to come one way or the other, even if they have good positions sometimes in the Midwest and other places. So people were always calling me to come in for interviews and so forth. And I always thought if they had something interesting to discuss, and so forth, I said, well, come on in. You know, if the students are happy with you, you can stay. After a year, you're on. And that was it, you know, and everybody was, and I worked. I never had a contract with anybody. It was my word that said you would not have a problem as long as the students were content. Okay, among the original faculty for the first, well, until from 72 to 79, 80, I think we got along reasonably well. I mean, there was a difference in some people's point of view, obviously, than other people's, and those discussions took place. But in 80, it started to get a little more contentious. And also, that's postmodernism was coming in stronger, and I was...
That's what I wanted to get you to.
Yeah. And I... I really felt that wasn't the kind of school I wanted. I didn't want to deal with this historical retrogressive position. I don't mind the other aspects of what people call postmodern. It was just one of those things. To me, it was a Charles Jenks game. People were trying to establish, you know, their positions as young people within this whole process. I was always one for more of continuum, personally. That was my feeling when I got into the field. I wasn't trying to change the field. I was just trying to be a participant. Okay. Later, I think the younger faculty and younger people across the country, established architects sometimes, wanted to have a new role. And so a lot of them adopted this kind of mentality. Okay, so that became a little more, you know, difficult in a sense, because I didn't want to do that. So I proposed a Futures Institute at that time, so that we could, those who were not interested in being part of this game would become part of this Futures Institute and could do what they felt they should do. And so, again, few of the people who are here tonight, I don't know, can't see who's here, but were happy to be a part of this at the beginning, you know. So, and the goal there was really to look at things again more scientifically or technologically, and or from other standpoints, behavioral standpoints, or from whatever, you know, other things. And in fact, we had a lot of our students came from Asia at that time, and who wanted to do master's programs at SCI-Arc, because we had a pretty good international reputation, and they were welcome, and we supported the country where they were from, and even their attitude about that. And Tony Gwilliam, who's here tonight, was one of those who was a strong advocate for that. Glenn Small was an advocate for some of the other things. And then we had, you mentioned NASA before, we had studies for NASA. That was probably the more popular of all the groups. But at that time, I even sent out a notice throughout the country that I would invite any student, tuition free, who wanted to join our Futures Institute. And I didn't get one taker in the whole country, because postmodernism was so prevalent in terms of what the magazines were doing that it was really hard to overcome that. And so I finally figured, you know, originally I had asked the guys that I wanted to be the director for 10 years. At the end of 10 years, we can move on, and because I think you kill an institution if you stay around too long, so it should evolve. And that's what started to happen. So I said, I'm pretty much ready to step down. I don't want to be ahead of a school that's dealing with postmodernism. It's not what I'm interested in at all. And I've had my turn, and I've enjoyed it. I've learned a lot. And the students, I think, had a lot of freedom, and they were enjoying the whole process too, I think, most of them. If they weren't, they left. We didn't fail. I didn't fail anybody. They just left on their own. So that was sort of the evolution of what was going on. But the contentious part became through that period, because it was different factors. We're not going to mention names of who was on what side. When Eric talked about it, he was always talking about it like we were killing each other or something, but that wasn't true. It was a verbal.
No, they're all still here, so it couldn't be that violent.
No. But it was a verbal. It was a verbal battle. And I'm not the most verbal guy in the world, but I had to be the one who was constantly, you know, fighting against that. And that was not the most pleasant time in the world for me. But it went on for another 7 years. By that time, Morphosis had done they had morphed and really became who they were, you know, Tom and Michael. And they then were very important nationwide at that point. They were getting a lot of press, winning a lot of awards. And it seemed to me that they should be the ones who carry on. By the time 87 came, when I stepped down, I could have been happy with the school again, because we weren't really into postmodernism from an historical standpoint. We were in, if you want to call it postmodern, I just call it modern. I don't know. I never understood how we got into all this modernist stuff and postmodernist and all. And that was just because of literature and art, who used those terms. And architecture was always coming later with those things. And it just seemed like, okay, they made it work as a terminology, but I was totally against it. Go ahead.
This is I really like that, but this is a great segue into to talk about in relation to your own work. I mean, this is the version of you that we know, but I find this one, which is...
That's what I used to look like when I had hair.
No, but what I'm interested in two aspects, because your body of work, in many ways, to a span of 6 decades, more or less.
More, yeah.
It has a level of coherency and conviction that remains very stable, I would argue. Maybe I'm giving a wrong characterization, but. One of the things I always find interesting in that relation is the notion of between your own desires and your own convictions as an architect, which you don't necessarily brought completely as an educator. I mean, like this notion that you're talking about science and so on, I would not say there was a parallel interest to it, but there is a certain dichotomy with your own work as an architect to a point. What I like about the notion of the young Ray Kappe to the guy who is one of the founders in 72 and the first director in 20 years, how the logic of your own work, the genealogy of your own work evolve into the conviction that the modern principle, the modern way to understand the world was the way to operate in architecture. Because in a way, your career flourished as a practitioner in the middle of when modernism was being put on the table and dissected as an autopsy and anything floating around. So how you navigate, but because also I would argue that your work is heavily influenced by the condition to be in Los Angeles, it's not the European version of it, it's already a mutation of it. But I'm intrigued how you internally, conceptually, you conciliate the conviction of your own work in relation with your interests, and you start to develop, as you say many times, you've always been interested in education, you were not so into an educator, but you became an uber-educator when you became a director. So how those different aspects of your own brain or emotion kind of start to negotiate a way to operate? I know, it's not an easy question.
No, it's,
and you can answer, basically any answer can really fit. It was a long question, but, well, but bottom line is, how difficult it is to stick to your guns and your convictions when the world keeps changing around? How much you're willing to absorb and change? Because again, to be part of an institution that is so dynamic like this, bunch of ideas will fly through that. How to pick, how to manipulate, how to create, how to elaborate?
Well, let me put it this way. The first, you know, roughly 15 years of my practice were fairly typical of the better modern architects of Southern California. Post and beam, interplay with the, you know, interior, exterior, all the good life ideas. We were, you know, that was where we thought things would be going after the war, and it was going that way for a while. And it seemed like, why couldn't we begin to convince people that this is a better way of living than living in traditional houses? Okay. So, and I picked up on, what was going on here, what was going on totally. Okay, so, Wright was already doing work here. We had Neutra and Schindler that were here. We had three disciples of Neutra who were, we had Soriano, we had Greg Ain, and we had Harwell Harris. Well, various people picked up on those in different ways. I mean, you had Craig Elwood and Pierre Koenig, along with Soriano, who were doing primarily steel houses. A lot of us, I would have worked in steel, except clients didn't want steel. So I was more interested in, you can still use similar technology, but it doesn't have to be in steel. It can also be in wood, but it's different. But I don't know if you looked at some of the early work that went up earlier, and most of you weren't here at that time, but it went earlier in the evening. But that work was not so different from the case study houses, but I never really felt I had anything that was pushing the edge enough to really ask John Intenza to do a case study house. He published my very first work, and he was very, it was an apartment, a six-unit apartment, and he was very supportive of young architects. So it wouldn't have been hard to do that, because it wasn't like you got selected. You brought a project to him, and if he thought it was interesting, you would do it. But he became more involved, caring more about steel than wood. But most of us were doing wood architecture, okay? And really, Harwell Harris was really who many of us were following, because he had reinterpreted the green and greenhouse. And then you had Neutra, who was doing pavilion-like places, and then you had experimentation by Schindler. And so that was the whole kind of historical process. And all I wanted to do was be part of that as a continuum. I mean, I wasn't, then what happened in mid-60s, when I did my own house, all of a sudden things changed for me, okay? I didn't mean to push the edge. I was just solving. I'm a problem solver. I'm not an artist. I don't subscribe to that. And I'm not a conceptual person as much as I am a pragmatic problem solving person of the site, the program, environmental concerns, the structure. All these are important factors for me. And my work always, and I was interested in construction systems. How could we begin to do, all architects would try this. Anyway, to make the building process such that you could do multiple housing for many, many people. And in the early 60s, I came up with what I thought was a modular system that could be either site-built or factory-built. And it wasn't really a tech solution. It was really just a solution that I thought would work using wood or steel, whatever people were using. And that was early 60s. And that in those years, I was very much involved with lots of other things too, planning, urban design. We were doing advocacy work. I mean, I was always sort of a dual-edged person anyway. The planning was as important as architecture to me, and the urban design issues were as important. So in our firm, I was working with the Urban Design Committee of the AIA, and there were three of us who pretty much took over that committee and later formed the partnership. But we were doing lots of studies of things that we thought were important in the process. So that was another element. And that was similar to what people do now is in competitions. We weren't trying to get work, we were just trying to make a point. And so we would work evenings and put out ideas, and again, Bill Simonian was working for Herb Kahn, and he was an associate there, and Claudio Boccato, who was working with me, was another associate. They were all participating in this process. And so one day we decided, why don't we just form a partnership? And we wanted to do a planning collaborative in which we could bring together all the disciplines and be able to compete with the bigger firms doing planning work. Okay, I'm going a long way around. Okay, so anyway,
you just want to make me look bad that I said that you were a man of.
No,
I know what's going on here.
I'm a man of. I mean, I don't enjoy talking a lot, except when I'm asked questions. I can never answer the question in a simple, one-off, really quick way. There's too many elements that come together, and you retrogress, you go forward, you go back, you go this. You go
you
that.
Sound like an architect.
So anyway, that was another aspect of the whole game, and that's really why I got even hired at Cal Poly. It was because we had been doing this kind of work, and I was always a fan of landscape architecture anyway, and so that's how, I mean, so I was happy to get into that kind of a situation where we had the three disciplines working together. Anyway, so what was the question? Okay. So my work was always about these construction systems up until 75, and actually my own house we used the system, but it wasn't, I supported it by concrete rather than wood because of the nature of my site, which had springs on it, and it had a slope that was 45 degrees to the street, and had a lot of strange parts, but that's what made the house interesting finally. And so that's sort of for me it's kind of a happening a lot of times. It's not so much preconception. And it evolved, and it had reasonable interest at that time. I mean, it has a lot more interest now than it did then, 50 years later. So, which is also an attribute in my mind, that you have work that can last 50 years and people come in and they think, well, that could have been built last year. Well, I think that's good. And that's what that was sort of my goal. So I never really pushed the edge that much. And when I did, the jobs always seemed to fall through. Or if I did, and I have jobs that if you were watching earlier, that are, they're not all wood and stuff like that, even though I'm known as a wood architect, they were jobs that people practically never got another job from those one-off pieces that I was interested in, because they had more of an idea of technology, okay? So through my career, I'm really always thrown back to 1965 when I designed my house. People seem to always relate to that house more than other houses, or houses that were part of that process. So during that time, what I did is I used my houses that were for clients to explore the idea of prefabrication. And that went on, and what I wanted to do is break down the box in doing this, so that you could show that it was possible to have space and excitement in a prefab. And so I had that, finally in 2004, Steve Glenn, who's here tonight, gave me the opportunity because he wanted to go into business. So I that happened, when, I don't know, 40 years later than when I first designed it. And we tried with several projects. We tried with student housing, and that didn't go ahead. We tried with, I was going to do an apartment unit adjacent to a 24 unit I had just done. And I thought we were going to on-site build this and make that work with prefabrication. It didn't go ahead. The condo market fell out at that time. I mean, the students here who don't know or maybe don't care, but you know, every time there's a change in interest rates, every time there's any kind of a recession, every time these things occur, architecture is affected by that. And there are periods where things don't get built because of those kinds of situations. The interest rate isn't, you know, good enough for people who want to speculate or even build a house or whatever. So those things go on. In my life, I had maybe a third of my jobs were never built because of that. I mean, various kinds of conditions that take
place. One third.
About a third.
That's a pretty amazing record, my friend.
What, one third?
I think half of the people here will sign their soul to the devil for to say one third of my project didn't come through. That's a remarkable.
I thought that was about average. I don't know.
No. At least not with this audience. Maybe okay. We're somewhere else.
Well, you all push the edge a lot more. When I would push the edge, those jobs wouldn't go ahead. That's why I went back to orthogonal design. I did other, I attempted other concepts and other language, and they never went anywhere. The client would always back out after we were practically ready to go into the ground. And of course, in those days, if you know you had a house for $25,000, it came in $27,000. They decide they don't want to build. That's too much increase. You know, today that's like nothing. But in those days, it was again. We were building for $10 a square foot. $15. Then it went up to about $30. And I remember thinking, well, boy, and finally it kept growing. And pretty soon it was $100 a square foot. I thought, who's ever going to build a house for $100 a square foot anymore? And so, you know, it's continued on. But I'm just saying there's lots of reasons that people stop. But the harder you push the edge, of course, the more difficult it can sometimes be, unless you're a super salesman and are very insistent and I certainly give Frank Gehry credit for his ability to keep on rolling with that kind of thing. I would have bet I don't know how much that those things would not go ahead, the earlier work that looked like they've been hit by an earthquake. And but at the same time, you know, he had that drive. So, you have to have that. Tom Main has that. A lot of people have that, you know, that insistence, that drive to move it ahead and to make their moves. I don't know many others of you may do the same thing, but that's when it's always harder, I think, to not have a job fall through. And I was more interested in exploring what I was interested in.
But so moving on, and probably maybe my last question. Yeah. So I don't want you to comment on this. I found this, and I don't know if you say it or not. And if you haven't, it's like Ho Chi Minh by now. I mean, there people make quotes. And
yeah, no, that's mine.
He says about the 10 principles that he guides you. And if you say it, they're really good. If you didn't say it, you should say it. So in one way or another, I just want to show it to the students.
I did say it.
Okay. So one time, okay, that's so, out of the way. You say it, no problem.
Somebody called me one day and said, what are the 10 principles that you think make you an important architect or educator? And this is who I am. You know?
Ten.
And,
So not three, not six, ten. Okay, some other day I'll ask you about why 10, but...
They asked for 10, okay, I gave them
10. 10 commitments, but, and again, this maybe is my last question before I want to open to people in the audience to ask, and is if you have, let's say if you were to come back today to teach in the school and to rethink problems and so on, what would be at the top of your list? What are the main problems of the dilemma that architecture as a discipline, not as a profession, is confronted today? I mean, what would be at the top of your list to say, okay, if I had to have a group of students and I had to run in a studio based on not so much whether my trajectory, my genealogy, but what are the problems that architecture will be facing today? What are the urgent qualities that it will define how architecture should operate right now?
That's hard for me to talk to, but I would I wouldn't teach anymore because I don't think that what I have to say is very relevant to the students who are mostly working in a completely different way than I've ever worked in my life. And that's, it's very formal in the way it happens. There are a lot of beautiful things that have happened, particularly since Hernan came here and introduced different software that created a completely different kind of a place. And when I've taught, the last time I taught, I gave a problem across the street at over the rail yards, and I wanted to, we were supposed to build how they would build in relationship to SCI-Arc and to the river, and they had to build with the idea that the trains could still go through below, so they had to come down. The structural aspect of where that would be very important. Parking was taken care of that way. The buildings would grow. There would be more openness between here and in the river, and it would also be a lot different than what we have across the street. But because they only took the front end of this, well, I didn't think the project was hugely successful because, first of all, housing is a difficult project for most students unless you lead with a strong, strong hand. And at the same time, the idea that they had to deal with all the issues of structure, environmental response, concern for all these aspects was sort of important to me. But it was hard for the students to handle it, and I'm not a teacher who leads strong. I usually want the student to come out of themselves, because I believe strongly in the idea that until the day you really understand who you are, it's very difficult to create architecture in any kind of a personal way. If you're not a person who thinks like what's popular in the magazines today, you have to have your own convictions about what you think, where you want it to be and where you're comfortable. And some people don't want to be comfortable. I like to be comfortable. And so my feeling always was that when I brought that to the school, it wasn't as interesting. We did a river study previous to that. I was always giving problems not related to what I do in my own practice of architecture, but problems that I thought were more interesting to be a part of the process of learning. And so that was the only thing, but it's much harder than when, it's like giving people, like we did when we first started here, what would you do if you could all do independent study? And that was the most difficult thing for anybody to be involved with. We had about 15, 16 students who thought they would love to do independent study until they were, given that opportunity. And then what happened is they realized that all of them were different, and but maybe we should, maybe all the independents should come together for a studio. Well, then they didn't agree on anything. Next thing, they have a psychologist come in to discuss it with them, and it was just like, well, it's like doing thesis all the time you're in school, because you have to write your own program. Normally, you're responding to an instructor's, you know, program. So when you have to write your own and be independent, it's difficult. It's very difficult for the students. And so I learned that that doesn't work so well either. And it doesn't, the ones who get the best results, physical results, out of a studio are those that are led pretty strongly by the individual who's heading that. And then you see, you know, really nice things on the wall. When I teach a studio, you got everything from the best to the worst. And I don't think that plays very well, and I'm not computer savvy enough to be around anymore. And I think if you're not, it's a difficult thing to teach. You can teach ideas like I'm talking today, but that's better in a seminar than it is in the studio, I think, today. And students can take from it what they want, but it's a completely different game, that's all. And I think there's nothing wrong with that. I think things have to advance, and I have no problem with that, but it's completely different. I when I went to school at Berkeley in the 40s, we didn't make models, we drew, that's all we did. We were still coming out of the Beaux-Arts time, but we were not doing Beaux-Arts architecture, we were doing modern architecture, but our problems were always 5 weeks long. You could come to studio if you wanted to, you didn't have to if you didn't want to quit. Turn in your project into 5 weeks, you don't present it verbally at that time. The jury comes in of four people, one of whom's your own instructor. They jury it, they hang it on the wall, like here, the best is there, the worst is over there. Students have to come in the room and where am I, you know? And so you get, and a lot of times I didn't agree with the
Those
instructor.
Were the good times.
Well?
Those were the good times.
Well, they were.
I wish we could, sometimes we can go back to that.
Yeah, but anyway.
There was some virtue in it.
Anyway, it was, for me it was great because I could, first of all, I could work my whole last year at 40 hours a week because I only had design. And I could turn in my project every 5 weeks and everything was fine. I did well. Anyway, but I would a lot of times have an instructor say, that's terrible what you're doing. And I thought, well, I don't think it's so terrible. So I wouldn't come back for a crit. And then I would turn it in. And I'd come in the room, and I'm over there, you know? And so then they would turn around, and the instructor already had forgotten what the hell he had told me anyway. And so at that point in time, they would tell you what some of the comments were as you went around the room. But we didn't have to say a word. If our drawings didn't communicate, you were in trouble. So you had to communicate through the drawing process. But it was what we call the inside-out approach, which you hear all the time. It means, you know, you really start more with the program, the owner, and the constraints that we have to deal with, and all the things that you have to deal with. It's not, you know, pie in the sky if you're really doing architecture. Half the time you're worrying about setbacks, you're worrying about height limits, you're worrying about planning and the codes and the God knows what. And, you know, and to be able to push through that just in a normal project is not an easy process. It's a difficult process. And it, you know, so if you get anything out, you're doing pretty well, usually, if you can get through that stuff. I mean, today, to get through planning is like pulling teeth. You can be in planning for a year, and they don't make a decision that makes any sense, and it's getting worse, and people are stopping jobs. Venice is a really terrible place to work now. You can't even move. And so all this you know, was going on. I don't know how I got back to here again. This is sort of the, and we're going, we're 21 minutes and 49 seconds over the.
No, we crossed the hour threshold, and I want to leave some time at least for a couple of questions from the audience to you. But so when you were talking to, when you were answering the last question, there was a huge amount of images from different houses that you've done. And there are many, many contributions I think you were did, but clearly the humanist dimension that you were at to the modern paradigm, I think is a major contribution that you and many other, not many, but some other California master, I think that produced a huge disruption, which I think today the notion of that level of the day-by-day life as a high form of architectural speculation, I think is an important one. In any case, I want to finish with, before, as I said, before we go into the questions, with a clip which I already apologize, Shelley, in advance, because you're such a gentleman and I know you don't approve the language. But since I'm not, I cannot resist to do it. So let's make sure that the sound is on. So. Sorry. And he has a Porsche too.
Oh my God.
You like?
Well, yeah, of course I like. It's a great Kappe house.
Great fucking Kappe. That's one of those guys from architecture school. They used to get you all juiced up.
Rid of
I thought maybe you'd like to see one all up close and personal. Like.
Hey, Hank, can you get back in the car? Because we're going to get tasered by the Bella Patrol.
Very expensive. M'lady.
What are you doing?
Just made a little deal with a caramel cup devil. Tasering. You like that? Is that something you're into now?
Oh, my God.
It's fucking gorgeous, huh?
Not a lot of closet space, though.
Hank never really got architecture as an art form.
Oh?
Too much compromise involved, too many practicalities.
Dude would rather hang out all alone in his ivory tower, right? Massaging those precious little words of his. Like anyone gives a fuck if it's an and instead of or.
You got me all wrong. You see, I try to live in an ivory tower, but a tide of shit is constantly beating at its walls.
Don't be impressed. He stole that from Flaubert.
Hey, Carr, if you don't mind my asking, how much a place like this set you back?
The feeling of real architecture?
Uh-huh.
You can't put a price tag on that.
So you do mind.
Make your heart sore.
Anyway. So maybe a couple of questions for Ray F. Kappe.
I answered everything. Huh? Okay.
What do you think about the future of modular housing, given that you've made a few attempts?
Well, right now it's picking up again. Steve Glenn told me the other day we got 44, not oh my design, but 44 in process at this time. He's opening up a factory, I think, sooner or later. I don't know when it will be. And I think it, you know, right now it has good, decent possibilities. So we'll see what happens. We're proposing some for a development, and in my case, so we'll see. We'll see. I was always for it. I never did get in tonight talking about energy issues, which were also really key for me. And I'm sorry, Steve. I forgot. But anyway, but energy was real important. And for Steve Glenn, sustainability, energy, we ended up doing the first LEED platinum house in the country. And that was the house I did for Steve himself as a prototype. And so I think it still has possibilities. It's never really gotten off the ground. You have to be, if you're not the developer, I mean, developers always wait for somebody to be successful before they really jump on the bandwagon. And once there's some success, they usually jump on fairly strongly for a while at least. It was just like the early housing in Los Angeles. A lot of That housing was done with developers like Alexander. Of course, I worked for Anson and Allen in San Francisco doing Eichler homes. Those were successful. They built thousands of those, and Palmer and Kreisel built thousands of houses in here in Palm Springs and so forth. So there was a time when it was going strong, then all of a sudden it stopped. The builders or the developers thought that the market was already saturated and it no longer was going on. And yet they were competitive. We first moved into one in the valley. It was, I was a GI, so you got that benefit, but I think it was $1,000 down. The house cost $11,000. It was $60 a month, to, mortgage. And so, it was very affordable. And there was one that was a little bit better that Palmer and Kreisel had done. And this first one was done by Ed Fickett. And that tract was a very, it's three bedrooms, 1,100 square feet. It was a decent thing, and it was a nice neighborhood because all mostly designers were out there, and we had a good time. It was the era of folk music and Pete Seeger and all this going on, and sort of a precursor to rock and roll that took place later. But it was a very nice period. And now I'm saying is that it could go, and it will sometimes go, but it's hard to get people who really want to put, the money forward to think that it'll work. So if you look at them, they think, whoa, who wants prefab? But the reality is you can't tell the difference. And once people walk in, there's a prefab, But, so people, and there's a lot of very nice ones.
One more question?
Pardon?
One more question.
Yes, sir.
Fred,
It's Glenn Small. Okay, I was wondering who that was back then.
Either it's Glenn Small or Wyatt Earp.
I'm the same guy.
What?
Where do you want Sire to go? You had your whole vision when you were directing the school, and now there's a new director, and you can put your thumb on him a little. And where do you want it to go?
I don't, Glenn, I think it has to go where it has to go. And, we're dealing with computers, we're dealing with forms that you were interested in, that you drew by hand in our early days, but that's where the students are, and that's where architecture is. And it's first of all, it's global. It's a whole change. The opportunities that architects have today are so different from what we had, what I had. I mean, I came out of a generation that would primarily. You figured you start with houses, and by the time you're 50 years old, they might give you a bigger building somewhere. And most of the public buildings weren't that great anyway. So I think, I don't know where it's gonna go. I know where when I talk to architects, they think, well, shouldn't it be a little more practically oriented rather than so computer driven? But I don't know that you can change things. I think each time the directorship changed, and I think that's what makes SCI-Arc still vital, is that it's led by somebody who has other ideas. When Michael took over, I mean, he was a lot more about making things than probably I was, yet you guys in first year were making things all the time. So I don't know. I'm willing to just go with it. I'm not going to change the world. I know that. I thought at one time I might, but that was when I was half as old as I am now. And I think finally It's very, very difficult. I think it's a process, and the process, as long as you let it happen in the way that it's evolving, I think it's okay, it's fine with me, and it might be a lot better. I think Hernan has ideas that are, you know, he's talking about film and he's talking about other things that might be just as important in as architecture to some students, and the idea that they can be a part of this process, and they do projects that are quite beautiful, and I don't understand them architecturally. I couldn't sit in on crits and make any intelligent comments, but I just feel that I'm happy to see it go that way. I'm not going to change it. And I'd like to see, the only thing I'd like to see incorporated as much as possible would be more interaction with the city of LA in terms of urban issues, social issues, things that have to do with environment in a broader sense. I think those can still be done no matter what you're doing. But if we're talking about individual buildings themselves, I think we have to accept the fact that it's computer driven now. And it's, each phase was different. There was a phase when students made models mostly, then it was axonometrics for a while, then it was something else for a while, and then when the computer really became prevalent, then it became, sort of the domineering attitude. That's also, I'm happy to just sit and watch at my stage of life. I don't know how many years I have to watch it, but I'm happy to just see what happens. But that's why I answered before that I don't think I'm relevant as a teacher anymore because I'm not with it in the same way. I don't design by computer. I can't change the way I've worked all my life all of a sudden at 80 years old, or to change your process. Yeah, I have to use my own process, and I'm happy with it. I'm happy in my own skin, so that's fine with me. I'm just happy to be an observer of what will take place over time. I think I've always been more issue oriented with housing or energy and sustainability, those kinds of issues that I think are important. And I think all the things that you care about, those type of issues are still important. But they have to be incorporated in the process, and that's, there's lots of very talented people here who can either do it or not do it, depending on how they feel. But, that's all I can say. I know you always want to change the world, but I gave up on that.
Okay. Thank you very much.